83. Return of the Mac Podcast. M.A.C. Moss, Andrew Carl.
We back.
Back again. Episode 83, number 3 of the video. Hope you're enjoying.
That's Heath Miller, dog.
Heath Miller, we gotta have a better 83, but we'll just let it roll.
A legend, dog.
We'll let it roll.
Another. Hold on, Wes Welker. Put some respect.
Oh, man.
Put some respect.
Didn't he do PEDs and shit, that Adderall?
No, we ain't doing that.
He's Corvette.
He's had a bunch of... Nah, that's your boy. Don't do that.
I'm just saying, he was really popping the Addies. That's like a Edelman did the shit too, didn't he?
I mean, all NFLs take drugs. What are we talking about?
You want something, but I mean, it seems like that's been something that's following these slot wide receivers for the Patriots.
Is they white? That's fucked up, man.
You're not doing that.
You know, they snorting them too because they're white.
Hey,
I'm gonna leave that alone. I don't want to take it to the next level.
Ain't talking about none of that white snorting shit today.
All
right, happy MLK Day, by the way.
Yeah, that's great. MLK Day. Get us a day off. We appreciate
respect.
And all of the other things that you did, of course.
Yeah, facts. Definitely appreciate the day off today.
Though. But it is nice. Yeah, get to record a little early. Get to take advantage of this natural light.
That's neat.
Not the beer. How'd it go this week?
Natties.
Anything this week?
Same old shit. Really? Ain't really nothing going on.
Man, I watched a ton of shows.
I've watched some shit too.
Been on Netflix, so I watched Lupin. Y'all seen that? This is like top five on Netflix.
British accents was throwing me off.
Yeah, I mean,
I can't believe you watched this because. Aren't you the one that refused to watch Money Heist because of the dub?
Now I'm watch Money Heist.
Money Heist is absolute fire. If you can watch the subs on
Lupin, I'm gonna watch it now.
You gotta watch Money Heist.
I'm gonna watch it now. But Lupin, that's just good. I guess it's kind of similar to Money Heist, but it's just about like one dude.
Situation stuff.
I mean, he's just like a con artist. He's just manipulate situations to work out in his favor. And dude's just super smart. He's always I'm always a step ahead type person. You know what I'm saying? So
right. I love those kind of shows. That sounds good. Somebody else told me to watch that too.
Yeah,
so I might start that today.
It's not even that long. I watched all of it in maybe a couple days.
Nice.
So yeah, it's not that long. I think it's only 6 episodes.
Oh,
yeah, it kind of sucks, but it's good. I did like it. Watch that. I watched Night Stalker. Night Stalker.
I watched that in one night.
That was good.
That's not that long either. It's
not like 4 45-minute episodes. Nice.
I ain't mad at the little short series joints.
No, yeah. I really like those.
I mean, it's for the documentary because they don't stretch that out at all. It's not like drawn
there's a few
out.
Shows that's been like short like that too. Like the
4 episodes?
Four episodes. They're like 10. I think another one was like six or eight. I watched. It's pretty good.
What else?
Knock them out.
Are the only two?
I started Bridgerton. I started Bridgerton. I've been watching that shit.
That boy Franklin, he expanded his acting career.
Oh, you said you watched
Idris.
Outside the Wire.
Yeah, that's good. Dance I watched that too. It's a solid movie.
That looked like it was a little too much for me.
It's a lot going on.
It looked kind of.
It's just an action film.
It wasn't like
a sci-fi type shit where it was unrealistic, like fantasy type
thing. It's definitely unrealistic.
I mean, action can go unrealistic.
Well, it depends.
Was it like superpowers and stuff?
No, like AI. And
the army had robots.
Right,
advance. Like I guess in like 10-20 years, their army would have robots.
The only thing that's unrealistic is the fact that what's his name's character.
Don't be ruining this for me right now.
They showed it in the trailer. He's an AI. He's an actual robot,
but he looks like a real man.
Papa Doc's a robot.
Yeah.
That's why he froze on stage.
He glitched. He didn't lose the battle.
That was a good movie. I enjoyed that. That was cool.
That poor guy is always Papa Doc to me. No matter what he does, the rest of his life, that's
a lot of good movies too. But
yeah, he's been Papa Doc
though. So I forget that sometimes though.
I can't forget that.
That was like his first major. I mean, that's the first role I know him from.
Is he ever gonna get his own movie, Marvel?
No, his character's not big enough.
Which one is he again?
The Nighthawk guy or something like that. I don't know. I don't think it's his character.
He's a whole superhero. Still calling him Papa Doc.
Yeah, Papa Doc.
Can't change the narrative. What were you watching?
I need to watch the new Your Honor John too. That Your Honor show was good, bro.
Is it over yet?
With Bryan Cranston?
It's not over yet.
I'll probably watch it all once it's over. I'm this far behind now.
What is it? Come on.
HBO?
It's not HBO. I think it's Showtime, I want to say.
I think it's HBO, bro.
I don't think it's HBO.
I don't know, I gotta check that out. It seemed like it was a good show.
But I've heard nothing but great things about it for anybody that watched it.
And it's about like a judge or something. His son gets into some shit and now he got a
whole bunch of white
try privilege. To work him. Yeah, okay, gotcha.
Oh, he was hiding, covering up everything.
Okay, gotcha. Sounds good. I mean, I'll probably check that out. I like the kind of political shows sometimes. So it's a cool
He's a beast, so.
Yeah, Bryan Cranston is a cold motherfucker.
That's right.
I must say. But no, I was watching that Night Stalker shit. I was just wondering, man, like, or, I mean, that shit was just wild to me, like, even, the shit was blasting on the news, like, everybody knew what was happening, like, you know, there was a serial killer on the loose, and motherfuckers were still, like, refusing to lock their doors and windows and shit, like, it didn't make any sense to me at all.
70s or 80s or something?
It was the 1980s.
Yeah, different time, because there was a bunch of other stuff that was, were just like, y'all couldn't, you're going off a footprint?
Yeah, right.
That's all they had was the footprint.
It's honestly wild that they solved the case the way that they did.
I thought the police did a terrible job. They did an awful job.
As a whole.
They had the alarm set up at the dentist office.
Yeah.
The same day they take it out or the no.
The same day they left.
The same day they put the alarm in.
And took the people out.
And took the people out. The guy comes in and the alarm don't work. It's like nobody tested this alarm. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
So they didn't want to help those investigators. They thought they were wild.
Yeah.
But I put the blame on that part on the owner of that dentist spot.
Facts.
Like you could have called.
Why did you call?
They're there and he just waited until 8 hours later. Hey, I just got home from work.
Yeah, he did wait till late that night to say something. Like, you came out early. Where was y'all at? What the fuck you called him immediately?
First of all, why did you put my man to sleep? You could have put my man to sleep and then called the cops. He would have woke up arrested.
He could have.
That's all you would have needed.
Yeah, check that out, though. That's a good one. We didn't get too much away. It's a true story, so it's all out there anyway.
Speaking of the A's, remind me of that crack documentary. Y'all gotta watch that shit.
That's on Netflix too?
Yeah.
I didn't see that.
I mean, I knew about the crack epidemic, but that shit was wild.
Do it get into like Rick Ross and stuff?
He was on there.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Really? He was on there, the real Ricky Ross, not Rosé.
I was gonna say.
the person he stole his image from.
Ricky Ross.
Yeah, right. All right. I'll check it out though.
That shit was good, bro. That was fucking, that Say No to Drugs campaign shit was some wild shit, bro. It was the wildest shit I ever seen. Like, just they had like actual commercials. Every star that was hiding during the time had a Say No to Drugs commercial.
Oh yeah, I mean, then when he used to have the crack is whack thing.
Yeah,
but she was all cracked.
It was before with the Reagans. The Reagans started the Say No campaign. Yeah. It's deep. Yeah, watch it.
War on drugs, man. Yeah. I mean, that's like the wildest thing to me. Is like war on drugs. Like, how you have a war on drugs? You have to. People use them. People sell them. It's war on people. You know what I'm saying? It's weird. But hey,
it's just deep.
I'll probably check it out though.
When the government was buying the drugs, that's the bad thing about it. They was buying them, bringing them in.
Yeah, right. I don't know anybody with planes. Yeah, you know, it's just coming from Colombia, bro.
You
know?
You have to use the military to get them in.
Yeah. That's where I'm not sure if Rick Ross, I might be thinking of American Gangster. Weren't they like flying them in dead bodies from?
That's American Gangster.
I forgot how Rick Ross said he was getting it, but I know he was like dealing directly with the CIA or some shit like that.
I don't know much about
it. Yeah. It was part, everybody was part of it because everybody was getting the cut. Everybody that was helping moving it was getting money. So they was helping bring that shit in. Usually. The type planes and all that shit, but you know. Everybody heard that shit. You know how that shit go.
I'll check it out. Give me something to watch.
Yeah.
Why not? After I'm done with Bridgerton, though. That's just good. That's just good. I ain't gonna suggest it because it's kind of a show.
The first episode.
Watch it with your girl or something.
I think it's one of those.
It's a lot of gossip and shit going on, but I like that shit. I like it. It's good. It's a good show.
You would, though. I'm good,
though. I heard it was like an ongoing soft porn like every episode.
I don't know about that. It's one of those shows. That's what you gonna see, some sex scenes and titties and whatnot. That's what you see in shows nowadays. It's nothing out of the norm.
Anything that's on premium cable.
Right. It's nothing out of the norm. But it's a the plot is really good throughout the whole thing. Still trying to figure out some shit. I'm like 8 episodes deep.
Mm. And the gossip.
Yeah. Yo, I stayed up to like 3 o'clock in the morning watching that.
Trying to find her husband and all this and that. Whatever.
Yeah, it's a cool show. I like it. I suggest it. Certainly if you're a female.
I was surprised they had black people in the kingdom and all that other shit. They was a part of it.
Yeah, it's a few. It's not many. It's just a few of us. Yeah, a few of us in there. Yeah, dude got some rank too. He a duke, so they tried to give us some status. They weren't just duke. Black maids in there. But yeah, it's a good show overall. I like it.
No Kyrie today. Y'all gotta wait.
No, I just seen that. Yeah, Kyrie. They said he's being held out for conditioning.
Oh, we did just hear that. I didn't even put it together.
Yeah, I think
today was the
Bucks. They said he'll be back next game though, or something like that.
True. Sound right. Sound about right.
Conditioned overnight tonight.
Are we gonna go ahead and jump into that?
May as well start with basketball.
All right.
NBA.
Yeah. So obviously, a crazy week for NBA basketball.
Crazy couple of weeks.
I mean, they're having a disaster right now with the coronavirus. Yeah. Now that they're not bubbled up, they're realizing
a game getting postponed.
At least a game. Yeah, it's a whole different ball game right now. They got teams playing with 7-8 people.
Do you think it's just because basketball players like really don't give a fuck? They just like living their life.
No, they're just outside the bubble now.
Well, I mean, you didn't see this kind of course, it was cases in the NFL. But for the most part, especially when the NFL first started, you only seen like 3 or 4 reported cases in the entire NFL. You know what I'm saying?
And they've got a sixth of the team, like total people involved.
Right.
There are so many less players. It does seem like it shouldn't be as big of a deal since the NFL did it.
Seems like it would be easier to control.
Right.
Yeah,
I'm talking like the NFL handled it well.
They did. I mean, throughout the whole season, they made it through it. Nope.
3 to 4 really big outbreaks, like that demolished a team for a week or two.
Yeah.
But overall, it went a lot better than I expected it to.
Sure.
They played every game.
Yeah, I was saying that would never happen.
Right. I mean, they played every game. But
they did.
Anyway, what's the big news, NBA?
Yeah, so that was a little something going on. Oh, well, I mean, there is more news there. So after all that stuff broke out and they're having all these problems, the NBA now is putting in different rules and stuff, and they're not, you can't, like, basically can't leave the hotel room, can't have more than, like, 2 or 3 immediate family members. You really can't do anything. Masks full throughout the game.
Basically, create your own bubble.
Yeah, they said they're not supposed to high five teammates anymore.
Really?
No dapping up in the free throw lane after a shot. Like,
oh, damn, they can't swap jerseys?
They're really trying to control everything.
No dapping up in after a free throw?
You can't get to the game more than like an hour and a half early or something. Like, there's a lot of rules.
They should just
see all that. That's
stupid. Yeah, I mean, if you're doing all that, just do like a super condensed season.
But at the same time, when there's an outbreak on a team, is the whole team, majority of the team gets it.
Right.
So it's like, it's not like you can sub another guy in or get somebody else on the team real quick. Like, if half the team gets it, you can't play. Like, you just really short unless you want to play with 7-8 players.
Yeah, I didn't see the details. I think there was something about expanding rosters and I guess having more like backup guys available on call so that they cannot have to cancel so many games. But I don't know. I mean, how does every team go pick up another 10 players?
Like, where do you go find? Utilize the G League. Every pro team has a G League.
That's what I was thinking.
Why not? Utilize your G League players.
Just pull some of those guys up.
That's a good point.
Especially since they've added.
That's what they're there for,
some
right?
Some of the veteran players that's already been played in the NBA to the G League recently. Like that's
essentially
Lance
what they're there for. To try to move up to the NBA and bring them up.
Yeah, I completely forgot about that.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, why not?
There was somebody, though, that had, like, really strong comments after one of the games. Did y'all see that? Do you know who I'm talking about?
Is that George Hill?
I think it was.
Well, they said, like, the NBA not going to tell me what to do and not to see my family and all that.
So we may as well not play if this is the rules.
I agree with him on that. Like, if you're going to be this strict about what you're talking, like, the things to do, then, yeah, we might as well cancel the season. Like I said, just do something super condensed. Maybe do, I don't know, fucking 40-game season or something.
I've been agreed with all the players saying that you can't.
When they're taking it to this extent, yeah, I do agree with it. I understand if you're telling players, like, hey, try your best to just go to the facility and then go to your house. I completely understand that. And, you know, try your best not to, you know, be out partying and stuff like that. Get all of that. But when you're talking about limiting, you know, family members and bullshit about, you know, you can't dap your own teammates up and shit like that. Come on, this is stuff that we really can't control, you know?
All the action shit is stupid, but just telling people to be safe, I understand it. If you're trying to keep people from getting it.
So, yeah, I agree with George Hill on that. Just, hey, this is some bullshit we probably shouldn't even be playing if these are the rules we're trying to implement for this season, because it's not realistic.
It's not I don't know if I agree with that part, but I've been on their side. You just can't tell players not to do. There's certain things that they can't control that, in my opinion.
You don't agree with it being not realistic?
No, that they shouldn't be playing.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
I mean, if they similar.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I think that was his main point. Like, we shouldn't be playing. I was like, no, y'all can play. Like,
it's similar to the bubble. If you don't want to play, then that's fine. Personally, you can opt out of the season. But to say that we shouldn't be playing is crazy. But the limiting of contact with family and stuff, and you can't leave your hotel room, basically, like. You can't tell people to do that.
But were basketball players offered the opportunity this season to opt out? I don't feel like I missed that discussion. That's what I feel like.
The NBA is so player-friendly and
they probably let them.
PR-friendly. I don't believe that they would like shame or penalize a player for it because they just like to have that image of we're safe, we're player-first and stuff. I don't think they would really push back.
Kyrie opted out. He didn't even tell them about it.
He did. Transition right into Kyrie.
Yeah.
So y'all know what's up.
Kyrie, like 2 weeks ago, just kind of didn't show up for a game.
This is after the team. That ruling came out. What happened? Oh, no, after the riots.
After the Capitol situation took place, he did not show up for a game. Told the team in general he wouldn't be there, but like Steve Nash didn't know why he was out or what was going on.
Right.
He ended up missing, I want to say, 3 or 4 games total initially from his leave of absence that he took.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that is when they started showing photos of him at his dad's birthday.
Yeah, family member.
Family member birthday party.
Wasn't he with some, like, I thought it was like some celebrities too, right?
I think they had mentioned Drake and stuff.
His photo somewhere with some celebrities.
Right.
Well, initially the party happened that he was getting called out for because there was a lot too many people and no masks.
Mm-hmm.
And then he was on like a Zoom live call during one of their other games talking to senators and shit like that. Like, I think it was an important meeting kind of thing, but it was just the optics of you can't be here for the game, but you're not like taking a mental leave of absence. You're going to do something else.
I saw one meme that said, "Is Kyrie's that dude that you asked to hoop and he'd be like, who all gonna be there?"
Yeah, I saw that one too. Yeah, definitely. But after that happened, he then was in trouble with the league for violating the health protocols and stuff. And they hit him with a $50,000 fine and made him miss had to do five days of quarantine before he could come back.
Yeah.
And that's really where we're at now.
And now he's ready to come back. And game checks.
Yeah, well, the games that he missed for being in quarantine specifically, they're just not paying for those games. So
are they doing that to everybody?
If you violate protocol and have to quarantine.
Right. Oh, okay.
Right. So not like if you got sick.
During that same time, KD was out quarantining as well.
Nah, he was close contact tracing or something. I guess he knew somebody, but
so that's something
they don't penalize him something outside.
Because they got the evidence.
Right.
It was like, oh, you was out.
So now that we filled you in on what happened with Kyrie.
Right.
We've had a week-long discussion about Kyrie and probably a year and a half discussion on Kyrie internally between the three of us that we've continued to have over and over.
Yeah.
Where do we want to go from here? How do we want to start this?
I mean,
yeah, I would like to hear your opinion first.
We have to add in the Harden as well because his shit was going on the same week where he was, where the shit happened after the game when they lost, it got blown up real bad. And they
I was going to go into that separate, but
we
could link it together.
But, I mean, what you want me to say? I mean, it was wrong for him to not show up and not tell his team. That was definitely fucked up. He should have did that. He should have told his coach and all that shit, let them people know. Shouldn't just not show up. But at the same time, he should have told somebody. But at the same time, we don't even know what he was doing. besides that
kind
of birthday party thing. Like, we don't know what the read. Like you said, I ain't heard a part about him being on a Zoom call with senators talking to government officials and shit. Like, I didn't know he was doing that shit. So maybe he was doing something and having to do with stuff that was going on during that time. You never know. Kyrie's been implementing that thing for a while now, so that wouldn't be. I can understand it if he was, but at the same time, you got to tell your people you work for that you're not showing up to games. Like,
there was enough reports that the reason behind all this was because he was upset with the Capitol situation. Right. So I'm just going to accept that as the case. You could argue it one way or the other because we still haven't heard from Kyrie.
Right.
I agree with
you. Never do, really.
Right.
I'll never.
Will we ever hear from him on this matter, though? Because already know what his stance is with the media now. So, and that's going to be the first question that they ask him.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's going to have to.
Is he going
to
interview?
He's going to have to because the league won't let him not. That's what he already got fined for before.
Maybe he'll just take the fines.
He could.
I don't think Kyrie don't give a fuck about the money. He's making a lot at this point, you know, so right. it's something that he doesn't care about. He's willing to risk, getting fined.
Yeah.
It's happened, several times for different instances now. So
he
might just keep it going. It's just something that he may not want to address at all. You might not ever hear Kyrie's side.
Maybe. I don't think that bodes well for him, but answering probably doesn't either.
Yeah, right. I mean, that may be worse.
You know? I mean, like I've said before, if he wants to be an activist and stuff, who can really kill him for that? Like, if he really is just, I need time off from basketball because these other things are more important to me. If you just say that, I don't think anybody really, he's still going to get crap because at this point, he is a target and people just don't like him.
Right.
But he so easily could make it easier. Like, if you just communicate with your coach and your teammates and tell them what's going on, that looks very different right up front. If you say, basketball is not important to me right now and I'm going to be working with other activists trying to get stuff done. Today it just came out that he bought a house for George Floyd's family. Like, I believe he is a good-hearted person and that he believes in this stuff. But you can do that and just, like, I feel like he does everything defiant.
That's the problem.
He doesn't
do things the way people expect him to do it.
Nah, but
and
it's
that,
not.
Because that is, like, even if he does dress up and when he does speak, people hate what he say when he speak. So it's like, I might as well just not say nothing to y'all, because either way, if I say something, y'all going to take that the wrong way and not like it.
Maybe it's not what he says, it's how he says it.
I mean, sure. I think Kyrie is in the same realm as, like, a Kanye or James Harden as well. People that just move to the beat of their own drum. You're going to rub people the wrong way. People are not going to like you.
Yeah,
like, this is what it's going to be.
I feel like that's a major cop-out. I agree with what you're saying, that he does move differently, and a lot of people just don't like that he is not quote-unquote normal. He doesn't fall in line with what society usually does.
I think he just don't give a fuck what people got to say.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. He does it defiantly, though. He wants to be criticized, and then he wants to say...
How do you know that? How you know he wants to be? He knows he's going to be criticized because he's a star in the league.
No,
how you know he wants? I want y'all to criticize me for this.
Because of his actions and what he says.
He knows there's going to be a backlash.
He specifically says things in a way that will be in your face and fuck you. He doesn't just say, I don't agree with this, so I'm not moving that way.
So he's not politically correct, is what you're saying. He doesn't say what he's supposed to say.
No, that's not what I'm saying. There's not a supposed to way to say it.
Right.
There's a way to just respectfully be a person and acknowledge, say what you are thinking, whatever you feel, do what you feel. I'm a very much an individual. Let people decide what they want to do. I don't want somebody here that doesn't want to be here. I'm not going to force you to be here. But there's a way that you can say, this is what is important to me. I'm not going to play basketball right now. And there's another way to just not show up and intentionally, like, put stuff out and do things outside of the protocol just to say, fuck y'all. Y'all can't make me do anything. So if you get, and
it's
again,
weird,
if
that's like, that's like your mentality.
Let me finish what I'm saying.
Y'all shit. You keep saying, my thing.
Yeah, but you keep cutting me off.
Go ahead.
So my point is, if that's how you want to do it, that's fine. But you have to accept criticism when you act like an asshole. And I think what he does, and I think what you defend him on, is he acts like an asshole. And then when he gets criticized, it's like, well, I mean, he's not doing anything. I mean, you got to be accountable for what you do.
I didn't say he was not doing nothing. I said he was wrong for what he did, not showing up at the work, and just basically brushing off his whole team organization for a week or whatever.
Right, but you keep saying that he is just taken the wrong way. Like, people are just trying to make him look bad.
You don't think there's a narrative of Kyrie that everything he does is going to be looked at bad?
Yes, because he's put himself in that position.
I mean, I guess.
LeBron is as outspoken, if not more outspoken, on everything that he does.
Yeah, I see
and,
that.
He, and he does it his own way. He still has a little bit of a fuck you attitude because he knows he's at the top of the totem pole.
Right. Exactly. Nobody can tell you the best in the league, but when you anybody else, you look at like an asshole.
No, it's not.
He got enough clout to do the same thing.
He's in the same realm of superstar athlete. LeBron does it, but he expresses himself and he says what he feels. Kyrie does whatever he wants and then gets mad when people say, yo, what are you doing? Whatever the fuck I want to do. I mean, you can't not explain yourself and then get mad when people say, what's going on?
When have you seen him get mad at people?
His whole attitude is always pissed at everybody.
I ain't never seen him. I ain't never seen him be mad at people except for the time he say he won't talk to the media.
When he did the bubble thing.
Him for the last 3 years. Yeah, I'm not talking to y'all.
When he did the bubble thing, there was tons of players that said, I don't feel comfortable playing. I don't think we should play right now. There's social stuff going on. And his whole thing was like, we shouldn't be fucking playing. I'm not with this systemic racist bullshit.
Yeah, so like, why was he the worst person when he wasn't the only one that was saying it?
Because of the way he expresses himself.
Look, I just feel like my stance on it is, Kyrie, if there's a lot of stuff going on that you feel like is bigger than basketball that you want to handle, that's fine with me. You should retire because you have a contract here that you should be fulfilling. But so my thing is, have you ever been with a chick that likes to burn sage and shit?
No.
Y'all ever seen it?
Never. I've seen it, but I haven't been.
All right, so normally when that's the case, they're the toxic person. They are the person that has the negative energy. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you feel like that's necessary, then the negativity is following you. Like, you're attached to it. Like, somebody who has, like, a positive perspective or puts off that kind of energy on a daily basis doesn't need to do those kind of things. You know, you wouldn't worry about that kind of stuff. So that's what Kyrie reminds me of, these like the toxic chicks who burn sage and shit. And
toxic
and,
to who though?
And the it use like all the of the universe and just in general.
I think you could easily make a case that his behavior is toxic towards the team and the teammates in general. I know KD is holding it down like a good teammate, as any good teammate should. He's not piling on or trying to jump on and take the media side right now. He's saying, you know, KD's my guy, or I'm sorry, Kyrie's my guy. He's doing whatever he's doing. But at the same time, the way he's handled this, there's no way that is not toxic towards the locker room in general. They're having to answer questions about him because he won't present his side.
I mean, yeah, you could say, yeah, having to answer questions about him, but I feel like everybody he's played with has never said nothing bad about him. Only people that said shit bad about him was fans and the media. Even when he was with us, when he was with the Celtics, every time they would ask a player about Kyrie and this, that, and the third, like, people wanted them to say something bad about him. They had nothing to say nothing bad about him. He said he's a competitor. We love him as a teammate. He's being, like, they say all the right things. You could say they were being politically correct and yada, yada, yada. Sure. But at the same time, it's like, if the narrative is not coming from the people he's playing with every single day and it's coming from everybody else, that means he's being toxic to where he's at. People just have that narrative with him. So it's like, I guess he just carries that wherever he goes because the narrative is there. It's not going to be removed. It's going to be there forever.
Do you think the whole, I understand that you think a lot of it is bullshit. Do you think the whole narrative is bullshit? You think it's all made up?
No, he does things that make or rub people the wrong way. Yes. Do I think he's a bad teammate, a bad player, bad in his locker room? No, I don't believe that at all. Don't believe that. All right.
There you go.
Yeah, I wouldn't necessarily say he a bad teammate, but I don't know. That's like, I don't know. Deep dive type shit, and there's a lot of shit that we wouldn't know, you know, because we're locker rooms and things like that to gather that information. But
I take more account of the people that's around him, what they say about him, than people outside looking in saying about him. That's what I'm saying.
But look, it's just a warning for anybody out there. If your girl is burning sage, leave. Leave. If she is burning sage, she is that's the negativity that you need to get rid of. Right there.
Wise words from Mr. Word.
Yeah, for the day, right there.
So whether he's a bad teammate or not, you're right, and I won't comment on that. I have no idea. I think his actions continually are selfish. And it's also the same problem that I have with James Harden, our next discussion of the NBA.
The beard.
Harden, catch you up if you aren't familiar with what's going on with him. He's been wanting out of Houston for the whole season so far.
Since they got eliminated.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yep.
So he wants out. He's made that clear. His performances have not been up to Harden level for the most part.
He won't even shooting the ball in Houston.
Right.
Right. He would like the shot attempts. He was taking like half the shot attempts that he would normally take.
He had one monster game. I want to say the first game of the season.
First two games.
40 points or something
like
that.
Yeah, yeah.
I think after he decided this was not going to be something I'm going to be a part of anymore, he very clearly, in my eyes, was trying to force his way out.
Yeah.
Then the last week or so, they got beat. And then in the post-game conference, he says, I had the actual stuff here. I don't know if it's really that important. But he said it's... You know, I've given the city everything I've got. It's crazy here. I don't think this is going to work.
He said it's not fixable at all.
The team is not good enough to compete for a championship or something to that effect. I think that's fair.
Yeah, he said we don't have the talent pretty much to compete for a championship.
And by the way, his averages are 25-10. He's averaging a double-double. So.
Yeah, well, I didn't say he's playing bad. Yeah. Well, look at his shot attempt. It's been...
He wasn't trying to win a championship. And his words after the game, it tells you that. It's like that's not what somebody who is giving full effort would say. Like, oh, we don't have the talent. A leader wouldn't say that. It's like, no, we're gonna work with what we got here. The guys that are in the locker room now, those are the guys we're gonna try to win with. Like, that's what a leader would normally say. So you could tell by his words that he wasn't out there giving full effort at all.
Right.
DeMarcus Cousins was not feeling it. He said the disrespect had started long before this press conference, kind of alluding to there's been tension there for a little bit this season because everybody knew he didn't want to be there.
John Wall won't feel it either. He said, man, we only played a few games. You can't just jump ship now. And that's how I felt about it. It's like, you know, we're so early into the season. What has been, you know, 12, 13 games or something like that total for most teams?
At the same time, Harden told the team he didn't want to play for them no more. They didn't get the trade done. The season started. So he's like, all right, I guess I got to go ahead and play and suit up. I ain't going to not play and miss game checks. So he went ahead and played. It's like, they should have traded him.
You think that's their fault?
I don't think it's their fault. He could have handled it better. But at the same time, y'all knew 2 months ago that he was ready to go.
Yeah, but they signed him to a 5-year contract or something 2 years ago or a year ago.
Understood.
They paid him. They made him one of, if not the highest paid player, like per season right now. He's getting 40 to 45 million.
And when they offered him more, he said, I don't want it. They should let them know he ain't playing with them no more.
They offered him 50 million a year.
50 million for the year. He was like,
that's cool. But that doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. He's because he's under contract. He signed to be there for 5 years.
And he showed up to play.
Not this year, he didn't. Once he decided I'm done, he pouted like a little bitch.
Okay.
He's had multiple stars brought there to play with him, and they can't win, in my opinion, because his style of play does not adhere to winning when you try to have the ball in your hand at all times.
Yeah, I mean,
but they've done everything they can to make the Rockets work.
They did the same swap out with him for the last 4-5 seasons. He's like, I'm tired of doing this. I need to leave.
What do you mean?
He asked for those players.
And John Wall and Cousins. They were trying to do another swap out. They shipped off Russ for John Wall, picked up DeMarcus Cousins, and then thought they was like, he's going to be cool with that. He was like, no, I don't want to do that. Like, why we keep swapping out another guard?
Every year, though, it seems like that they've tried to build and they have, though. I mean, the Rockets have been competitive. They've been a top four team.
Yeah.
And
they've been in the playoffs every year.
The organization, I think, has done right by James Harden. It hasn't dealt him a shitty hand. At the end of the day, it's a lot of the times it came down to James Harden. Like, bro, you made it to the conference finals a couple times.
And
you
choked and
you made it deep into the playoffs a couple times. And it's just it's instances where you didn't get it done. And I understand you were playing against some great teams like Golden State and stuff like that at the time. But still, you're supposed to be James Harden. It's, you got to get it done in these situations. You can't blame it on the organization for not, you know, getting you certain guys or whatever. It's not that many great players to go around.
I think he just felt like his time was up in Houston. I don't think he was blaming him or anything for whatever happened. It just didn't happen. So he felt like he just needed to move on. So I ain't mad at that.
Yeah, but ain't like accountability comes into play at some point. I mean, that's like the best sign of a leader. You got to be accountable. Like, put it on yourself. Why is the reason why we did didn't get it done in Houston, James. It's because James got to look at himself and say, hey, yeah, it's because of me. I'm the best player on the team. We made deep playoff runs. I was an MVP. I'm averaging the most points in the NBA. At some point, you got to point the finger back at yourself. You can't say we don't have this guy or we didn't have that. It's you, you know?
So side note for comparison's sake, I think it was two nights ago, Luka had a game where he had something like 38, 16.
Crazy, 15. Yeah, crazy.
Just retarded.
The first half one.
Yeah, and they lost. And after the game, he said, I played selfish in the second half. I had 30 points at halftime, and I was trying to do too much. I was paying attention to my numbers, and I was being selfish. I can't do that. That's why we lost. And he took the blame and acknowledged that he messed up in that game. Got caught up in the moment, whatever you want to call it. But, I mean, I know that's a very small sample size. We're talking about one game, a fresh player, not somebody that's been at the same spot and is frustrated. But the point remains, like, there's a way to acknowledge that the way I played, even if it looks great in the box score, was bad for our team. I messed this up. That's my fault.
Right,
I'll change that. I just feel like that's the kind of thing that Harden hasn't done or doesn't do.
Right.
He believes that it's, you know, hey, I'm putting up numbers. Y'all got to do something to fix this.
That, I think I ain't never heard him say that, but I feel like both of y'all
that's
issue.
How he feels for sure.
Both of y'all issue. See, he ain't never said that. See, that's both of y'all issues. Both Kyrie, both Kyrie and Harden is how they address the media or how they address everybody watching.
I don't have
that's what I see.
I've never liked Harden's game.
No, so put it this way: all right, Luka can say all the right things after the game. Let's say 5 years from now, Luka wins the MVP, wins scoring title, does all the things that Harden did in the last 6-7 years, but never wins a title, never gets to the finals, never has a situation. But he always says the right thing. Is he going to get the same criticism for not having taking his team to a championship?
He'll get the same basketball criticisms. He won't get the same personal criticisms.
Right.
Okay.
I mean, that's fair. Yeah, right.
If you don't
it's just like Giannis.
If you don't get the job done, you should be criticized basketball. Giannis is a good example.
Right.
And I don't criticize Giannis that much. I still think it's early enough that he doesn't deserve a full criticism yet. But that's another story. I think basketball-wise, Luka would get killed in that regard. But if you're not openly doing the things the way that they do, I don't think he would be killed personally, no.
Okay. I believe it. I believe he won't either.
Yeah.
The people like Luka.
Yeah,
exactly. What comes down to
because people
already
like Luka. So he can never win a championship. People will still like Luka.
Harden was once very likable.
I don't think he ever had a media problem, Harden, until the last four months.
Right.
I don't think he was like a media problem. I don't think people gave him shit. They criticized his game and stuff.
I'll say, yeah, people hate his game.
It's just about
a lot of people feel
played.
Like you. They hate how he plays. Always getting fouls, always shooting threes, dribble, 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 shoot. They hate his game. He just gets buckets. I understand that, though.
But nobody's been, like, do you think he's been criticized as, like, he's difficult to deal with, bad teammate type stuff? I don't think I've ever heard that about him.
I mean, maybe not difficult. Well, I mean, people just hate how he plays. They feel like he'll never win a championship by how he plays. Just Harden being Harden on the team that he is. Yeah, I feel like it's extra, though, because he don't win championships against the Warriors. It's like, LeBron is the only person that beat him. So now if nobody else beats him, it's like, I don't feel like he should get extra criticism. Like, Dame don't get that criticism. Who's other players in the West that lost to the Warriors? It's a few of them.
Right.
Like, it's like nobody was beating them. So I guess because Harden was an MVP candidate and had a scoring champion, it was like, you should be in title contention. But it's like, no, the Warriors is whooping their ass every year. The closest they got was that year with Chris Paul, and he got hurt, and they lost again. It was like, I mean,
I agree with you.
I feel like a lot of things have to come into play for a team to win a championship.
It's hard to criticize losing to the Warriors, that Warriors team. So I feel you in that. I think what led to him being criticized more is, I mean, I guess you could say somewhat of a media narrative of when he's putting up the numbers that he's putting up, he's entering the conversation of MVP and is he the one of the best players in the league kind of thing.
One of the best scorers all time, some of the numbers that he's putting up. Literally.
So when you start getting in that level, then it's like, well, I don't think so because of this. And then the champion stuff gets talked about.
Right.
And I think that game 7 really bad performance that he had the 1 year against the Warriors really hurt him. And the outlook on him
because he got so close.
Yeah. And then of course, and like I said, it's all basketball criticism. The defensive criticism that he's had in his career really hurt him probably more so than anything else.
But at the same time, even the basketball criticism, I feel like he adjusts his game every time, every year. Like, remember that year when he played point guard for the season? Like, he'll adjust his game. People say he won't pass the ball. And then he averages over 10 assists a year. Yeah, and then they say he didn't play defense. And he was the second-rated defensive player last year when they say he didn't play defense. For the last 2 years, he played great defense. It's like every year he's improving, adding stuff to his game. But because of the offensive game that he plays, he gets a bad rep. Because people hate how he plays. And I understand it, but he improves every year. He adds something else to his game. He's a triple-double guy. No.
Well, maybe he just needs to. He's nothing really that he can improve upon on the basketball floor. Maybe he needs to just improve himself.
I think as we get to now, I think he answered all his questions. He has KD now, and soon to be Kyrie.
Yeah, fast forward. Now
that's gonna change a lot of shit.
So what happened is he was traded to the Nets. It was the fucking blockbuster trade. It's a 3-team deal, right?
Yeah.
Cleveland's in it.
Talking about LeVert though.
Brooklyn
so he
gave
done
up
for this indefinitely.
Yeah, I was hoping that would nullify the trade, but it didn't.
That's crazy.
Yeah, they found like a mass in his lung or something.
A kidney, what? The kidney, I think.
That maybe kidney. That probably makes more sense.
So he's done indefinitely.
Definitely out, but they said they expect him to make a recovery.
For bad for him because Karras is about to get off with the Pacers.
He really was.
He's about to get off.
All right, so he went to the Pacers.
Yeah. So Brooklyn gave up LeVert. What's the guy's name? Allen?
Jared Allen.
Yeah. I wanted to call him Josh. 4 first rounders.
Yeah.
And I think that's the main package. There may be another side piece to something.
Yeah, that's the main package.
The Rockets got LeVert and flipped him to the Pacers for Oladipo.
Yeah, okay.
So that was part of something around the trade.
Yeah.
So the Rockets got back 4. Yeah, they got 4 first rounders, Allen and Oladipo out of it. Pacers got LeVert. And the Nets obviously got Harden.
That's all like basketball trades,
I think,
like that.
Cleveland was just a part of it too, didn't want it?
Yeah,
they had Jared Allen went to Cleveland.
Yeah, I think he went to Cleveland. Maybe. That's all. Like, that's why I don't fuck with the basketball. Football trades, cut and dry, fucking black and white.
There's no trade.
Yeah, right.
Nah, I fuck with the basketball.
I like the first rounder for this guy, second rounder for this guy. It's just a 2-team deal. In basketball, it'd be fucking 4 or 5 teams mixed and lumped in.
It gets like that when you're not trading a star player for a star player. When you're trading a star player for non-star players,
that's
you're going to throw in picks and some role players and a rebounder. You're going to throw in a whole bunch of
teams.
And you're adding another team. Yeah.
Well,
you have to do that because Brooklyn didn't have enough to just get Harden straight up unless they was giving away Kyrie and KD.
Yeah, the extra teams usually get thrown in to dump or add cap-heavy guys.
Yeah.
They're not really a part of the trade as far as Cleveland didn't get anything out of it, but I believe they probably took on a big contract or two that expires next year, and that is usually what happens.
Yeah.
I don't know the specifics on this.
Yeah,
thing,
yeah, yeah. That's normally how it goes.
They're more just a couple guys. Financial figures is really all it is.
Right.
So anyway, the trade happens, and now, of course, the discussion is the Nets, how they will finish the season with KD, Kyrie, and Harden.
Yeah.
And what
first
the expectation
game.
Is.
Just the Orlando Magic.
Do we think this is the best Big Three assembled?
The best offensive Big Three, I believe.
Yeah, the biggest Big Three, I would say. I guess the three biggest name
biggest
of,
stars,
of a Big
yeah,
Three.
As, yeah. as a whole, yeah, yeah.
These guys are elite of the elite. KD and Kyrie probably are the two best scorers in the league. So that's retarded.
I mean, Harden.
That's what I meant. Yeah. KD and Harden.
Yeah.
No disrespect to Kyrie. He's in that top 10 scoring list too. But I mean, they might be 1 and 2. So yeah, I think this is the biggest Big Three.
Offensively,
in that regard.
I mean, scoring wise, like literally putting the ball in the cup. I don't think they're gonna have any issues there. I just don't know. Like, who's gonna be willing to give up the time? KD's fine. He can play that catch and shoot role, but Harden and Kyrie really not catch and shoot kind of guys. They like dribble. Let me get in my rhythm kind of player. So
well, they all three are.
KD can catch and shoot.
Well, yeah, KD can do everything.
KD can do it.
He can score any type of way.
Right. He played with Golden State, yeah. And that's kind of was their formula with everything.
KD's the one that nobody has a problem with. It's really about Harden and Kyrie.
The weird thing is the best of the three is the one that could most easily take the number 3 role. of like stepping back and letting them kind of lead.
Yeah,
because he's the only one that could do that, and he's the one that you don't want to do that. He's got to be the number one.
Well, he could do less without the dribbling. Like, so that's what, he let them bring the ball up the floor or whatever, and KD can post up or spot up, get in the corner. I don't really know exactly how it's worked, but I mean, they have a good offensive mind and Steve Nash there to put people in position to win.
They're going
to
get buckets. If anything else, they're going to get buckets.
But
for sure.
Easy. At this point, though, you know, it's simple. If they don't make the NBA Finals, it's a bust of a year. Really, I mean, I think if they don't win it, it's a bad look. Or really, it depends on how they lose it. If you lose the NBA Finals in five,
I guess,
then it's a bad look for everybody.
I'm not a believer of it. As soon as a team get together, they got to win it this year type shit.
Neither.
I don't believe in that shit.
I give it a year.
With that talent, they definitely should at least make the Eastern Conference Finals at the very least.
They should win the East. They should win the East.
Would you consider it a failure?
There's some good teams in these. I know people like to shit on these. There's still some good squads on the East still.
But we're not looking at nobody that's got that kind of firepower.
I mean, of course.
Not even close. Not even two people that can do that. You know what I'm saying? Like, what other team? The Bucks? They not fucking with them.
Celtics still there.
Boston's probably got the best.
Yeah, our duo's been
Boston balled. Might have the best.
Kemba just came back. We still got a little squad.
Yeah, but they should get ran over. I mean, realistically, you don't have anybody to stop KD for real. You know, no, I mean, that's,
I mean,
no,
nobody does.
What exactly. Does? And then you, got, then you got these other two dudes who can give you 30. So I don't know about that. I think it should. The way
we saw the Heat clean everybody up in the Eastern Conference, and nobody expected them to do that shit with all them young guys.
Yeah,
it's possible.
The Heat won't play in KD. They won't play in.
I mara mean, they James Giannis Harden. As the MVP of the league.
Yeah, but like, we know what Giannis' limitations are offensively.
Sure.
These guys don't have that.
I think we're going to look back on this Heat team and say they're a good team.
Right,
no big deal.
Yo, they've been sucking this year.
But we will look at that one season and be like, what the fuck happened?
Yeah,
that's
the bubble effect. How the fuck did they make it to the finals?
Yeah, the bubble effect. Yeah, see that effect. Being a real thing.
It's the bubble effect for sure.
If they don't win the East, would you say that is, I don't want to say failure because that's like the final decision that's been made, but a disappointment if they don't win the East?
I'm sure they all want to win a ring. So I'm sure if they don't win the ring, they're going to feel like they failed, of course.
I mean, as a fan or a basketball
As a fan,
analyst.
As long as they plan on still being with each other for the next 3 or 4 years, maybe, don't run. It's all right. You got time. If you don't win it this year, you got 3 more years to win a chip. I have no doubt they'll get there at some point if they stay together.
I don't think it's a championship or bust the first year. I give them 2 years on that. But if they don't win the East, I would be like, damn. How did that not happen? I would
but
be
then,
shocked.
At the
that.
Same time, it's like y'all expecting them, the team, to come together first year and beat a Bucks team who's been together the last 4 or 5 seasons, to beat a Raptors team who's been together the last 3 or 4 years, to beat a Celtics team who's been together the last. Now, these teams have chemistry and they play playoff ball. Like, I understand these are playoff guys too, but it's still that chemistry and all that getting shit going. And they ain't got a deep bench. Their bench is depleted now. So that's in the
simple.
Playoffs, you
that's
gotta
simple.
Have a bench. I mean, yeah, it's their problem, but that plays a point.
They don't have to have one.
They got 65 games.
The Lakers didn't have a bench.
In the playoffs, you do need
the
to have
Lakers
a bench.
Didn't have a bench
and
last
they used
year.
Them up on the bench.
And LeBron and AD were the story.
They was every series they was using Dwight differently. They was using what's his name differently. The other big bad.
We're not.
They was using Alex Caruso differently. Every game, every series, they was using their bench differently in
but
the game.
We're talking about
they was using different starters every series too. They was using their bench.
Yeah, but you just said Dwight Howard and Alex Caruso.
Right, right. The people
they
that we
got
don't
production
about.
From guys that were not supposed to be good players, but they're not big names. I mean, I think as the season goes on, especially as you get closer to the trade deadline and they start cutting veterans, they're going to have the same thing happen that all the big three teams get. They're going to have some old vets that get cut from a team
probably.
Just for that'd salary reasons, and they'll sign on with Brooklyn because it's the easy decision.
Yeah, right. Get a quick
makes sense.
Check.
Yeah, it absolutely does. Absolutely does. But, I mean, they've got 65 games to figure it out. It's not like it was a late season trade where they've got a little bit of time to get it figured out. If you have 3 of the top 10, arguably, top 15 at worst players,
yeah.
You don't get much slack. You gotta get it done.
I mean, what, the first game already, just Harden and KD, they come out and score
32-42.
42-32. Harden had 14 assists or something.
They had a lot of turnovers that game. Both of them. Yeah. Both of them had like 15 turnovers between the both.
Harden had 9. I know that. Yeah. He almost had a quadruple double.
Yeah. So you won't like this, but I think they would be better off with just those two.
Of course, after seeing that, yes.
I think those two teamed up together makes more sense. And I think that they will never happen. Don't get me wrong.
And Jeff Green on squad, and they was all OKC together. It's kind of fire.
Yeah. I think they would be better off trading Kyrie for three good players. Like contributors and filling out the team more and let Harden and KD go nuts. That won't happen, but I think that would be
the
better.
Conspiracy about Kyrie is, and that's like the reason why he like went rogue and left this shit is to make him untradeable.
Yeah,
and therefore they can get Harden for pretty much pennies and then keep all three of them.
I did see that.
Yeah.
I mean, how realistic do we think that is?
No, I don't do conspiracies.
At all.
I don't.
Not at all.
I'm buying
it. But it plays along with the narrative.
I'm buying it.
No, I think you can disprove that conspiracy right off the bat because that would have been the team first decision, and Kyrie doesn't do that. So, fuck out of here.
That's a fact. That's a fact.
Let's see how they play once Kyrie gets back before we be ready to ship him off. If it don't work, maybe I can see what you're saying. That may make
sense. Right.
You heard what Chuck said. He went from the KD went from the Splash Brothers to the Dribble Brothers.
That was a good one.
Yeah, it's gonna be a lot.
So, I mean, while we're on the same realm, I just want to hear what you heard what Shaq said about Harden, right?
I can't remember what he said. I think I seen it. I can't remember.
He was pretty much saying the same shit that we just said, right? That
everybody was telling.
He said, "When you say you gave the city your all, that ain't true. When it comes time to show up, he ain't show up. If he don't win this year, it's a bust. Period." I don't really like that quote as much.
I think people just see it. That's the thing. People pour it on.
It's a bust.
It's a bust. If you don't win this year, you're done. Like,
but that's the attention that you attracted when you come out of there and say, this team's not talented enough to win a championship. And you go to a team that is talented enough to win a championship. Oh, we expect you better deliver at that point. I mean, and it's not to say that.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's not end all be all or nothing like that, but you set yourself up for the criticism in the situation.
Right, but I agree with you. That part was the pour on. The thing that I thought was more interesting about what he said is what he was saying about giving your all to the city, and basically said you did not. Like, you were not putting in an effort at all this year. Not at all, but you were not giving full effort this year, and you cannot say that you gave it your all.
This
and it
year,
just didn't work.
Those 10 games, is that what you're talking about?
It was part of what he's referencing.
Oh.
And when Harden leaves and says, I gave it everything I could, like, you haven't been recently. Don't try to say that. Like, sorry, it just didn't work.
This season, no, he didn't. But he plays the most minutes out of anybody every season. And so people say that's the reason why he falls off in the playoffs. Like, he needs to ease up a little bit because then he hits a wall in the playoffs. People are giving him that excuse. But I just think he just hasn't played well. I don't think he hasn't given his all. Like I said, every year he adds more to his game or he changes the game.
I'm talking specifically this year. I know you said, yeah, this year, maybe not. But I just want to ask you directly.
These 10 games, no, he didn't want to be there.
That's what I was thinking. Yeah. And then Harden's response.
I thought he was saying that like about his whole career. No, he elevated every year. What are we talking about?
No, I don't think he's a guy that doesn't try. I think he cares about basketball. I felt like he made it seem like, yeah, I don't know. I didn't like the way he played.
Oh, he didn't give a fuck about that team this year.
It made it seem like he did.
Yeah, was he wearing a fat suit?
He definitely had to.
It was amazing.
Unless that was just a terrible angle.
I think he had a lot of layers on.
Because
he had his warm up, he had his under stuff on. Yeah, I think it was just layers.
It looks like a 25-pound difference.
Yeah, it really does.
It did.
But he responded, and I hate this shit. He said on Instagram.
Who Harden did?
Yeah.
I see this.
In response to Shaq, in general, he said, we do all this talking about uplifting the next African-American athlete, and some of these ex-NBA players use national TV or their own social media to do the opposite. I see it. I just say to myself, the real never lose.
Don't make it about that.
I feel like
this is what players be feeling like. players always feel the type of way about players that go on TV and be media now and to be extra critical.
But this is his job.
Every player feels that way because it's like, yo, you one of us. Why are you coming down on us?
It's regardless of if Harden was white or black, though.
But that's his job.
Shaq would say the same thing if it was Luka. If it was
Luka, maybe the black thing was extra.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Like, don't try to play that card. I don't believe that at all. It had nothing to do with it. He's criticizing you about what you did on the basketball floor, regardless of your race. Yeah, I'm sure he still supports you as an African American man, but you gotta just own up to it. Say, hey, I didn't get it done in Houston. Just say that. And now I'm on to a new journey. Prove Shaq wrong. Get Shaq just saying, hey, go out there and win a championship. And then Shaq don't have anything to say.
Right.
It's on you now. You know what I'm saying? So don't play that card. People always play that shit when they feel KD butthurt. And
Kendrick Perkins, he'd be feeling so much of a way about Kendrick Perkins.
Yeah.
It's like, yo, you was my teammate for years, bro. Like, what is wrong with you?
But this is what guys get paid to do now.
Yeah. Perkins is annoying, though. He went full, okay, I see what Stephen A. did, how he blew up. Having
he be going for
hot takes. Perk likes to hear himself talk.
He ain't got no more friends at the end.
But he don't speak well. He does not speak well. Some of the people that I hate to have, or like these athletes, all athletes don't need to talk sports because they're not good at it. You know,
well,
not
he's good
at
for TV.
Yeah, that's why they like him because he says that wild shit.
Yeah, he's gonna say some stupid shit.
I hate that stuff.
They don't have to retract it 2 days later because it was so dumb. He's done that a few times.
Like that. Come on, man. It's like, yo, shut the fuck up, okay?
I hate Kendrick Perkins, man. They need to take him off the television ASAP.
Agreed.
For sure.
Is there any other basketball those were the big things that I know we had been talking about all week?
No, nothing. Nothing else for me.
Man, I feel sorry for that boy Bradley Beal, man.
He leading the NBA in scoring right now.
He is balling his ass off, bro. They ain't got to get him up out of there, yo.
He should have gone
sad. That shit is sad, yo.
Bradley, I don't feel any sympathy for Bradley Beal.
He should have never re-signed
the deal, knowing that that team is not going anywhere.
But he will force himself out now. This is some bullshit. They all want to re-sign for the biggest crazy money, but the Wizards were never going to be good. I guarantee within this year or next, he wants out.
Of course. Why wouldn't you? You can't just wasting away your prime years where you balling your ass off to be the last in the East. Really? Like, you can't. Like, what? What's
should've
the point?
Never signed there.
He like Devin Booker with the Suns his whole career until now. They've been balling this year. Now you got CP3.
Yeah, they look good. They look good.
Yeah, I feel bad.
Yeah, he should have just picked his own spot.
34.9 a game.
Yeah, I mean that's a big one.
They are 3-8.
Yeah, didn't he not make the All-Star team?
He did.
I think he was like the highest points per game total ever to not make the All-Star
team. Because he averaged like 30 points or some shit
last
year.
Something like that. Yeah, he's a killer. He's a great player.
It's terrible.
Any thoughts on Russell Westbrook?
He's been hurt, right?
He's been playing, as far as I'm aware.
I think I heard last week he out for the next 3 weeks with his thigh issue or something like that.
Maybe. Yeah, I haven't heard anything about him.
But he hasn't played good in the beginning. He didn't play that good.
You know how I feel about Russ.
I know.
Yeah.
I like him, but I've now given up on his style of play as well. I think he's got to change. But
he plays so hard that you want to root for him. You know that he's playing so hard, and really for the right reason. He's playing to win.
Yeah.
But it just doesn't work out for him.
Russ, I will agree at this point, he hasn't changed his game at all.
Like
the narrative that Harden gets and Russ is kind of the same, but Harden has actually changed his game and evolved as years went on. Russ is the same Russ he's been since KD was there. He hasn't changed. He's been that. Like,
Russ will never lean more into it. He'll never realize that he's not a good shooter.
He just will never realize.
You're a point guard. Like,
I mean, you gotta shoot him.
Yeah, you gotta shoot him.
You gotta shoot him, but you can't jack him.
Right.
And this is what you're not the type of stop and pop guy. Stop doing that. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Stop doing that immediately. So you gotta learn it about himself.
It's tough for us.
Yeah.
I think we should get into the football.
Let's do it.
So that we don't run out of time here. Which game do you want first?
What game? Let's just go in order.
First one is the Rams Packers.
Yeah.
All week, all four games were a lot better than I expected, to be honest with you.
Except one of them, but yeah, we'll get there.
Which one is that?
The Ravens-Bills one.
Oh, yeah.
They scored in the third quarter.
Yeah, I guess I meant closer.
Right.
Closer games than I expected. I thought a couple of these could have got out of hand.
Nobody scored over... It was like nobody scored over 28 points, right?
Packers had 32, but they got it late, though.
Gotcha, yeah.
Big defensive games all around.
Yeah, mostly. I mean, really, my only take from...
What about Ramsey and Adams?
Oh, did you see that?
That was one of the main
things.
I didn't see that.
Before the game started, Davante Adams walked over to Ramsey and said, I want you to follow me all game. Let's get the people what they want. I'm not like the other receivers that you've been checking all season. To his face. And the cops came over and broke him out like they was going to fight. No, he just had to address that shit like, I'm going to let you know I want you to follow me all game.
He not like the other wide receivers that Ramsey normally locked down. Ramsey will lock down like the big, like, not quick twitch guys.
We got to address the locking down shit because I just found out a couple weeks ago that Ramsey don't even follow number ones every game.
No, I mean, a lot of teams don't do that, and I'm fine with teams not doing that.
I think it makes a difference in your shit of Ramsey's the best cornerback we've seen in two decades.
I said I didn't say
you did.
Cornerback. You I did. Said defensive back because guy, he can guy. Play multiple Small positions.
This guy, bro. This guy,
right? That is what he said.
No, I reiterated it twice for you in the chat.
But I understand he used to play safety in college. He's played cornerback for his whole NFL career.
Right,
he's
a cornerback. But that's why I compare him to Charles Woodson and Rod Woodson because they came into the league playing cornerback and they were all stars, all pros at that level.
And they got older.
Later on in their career, as they got older, they started playing safety.
That's what happens.
Like I said, but no, it's not.
Not everybody does it. But once you get older, if you was an elite cornerback, they're going to move you to safety because you're not as fast as you used to be.
I don't. You got to find me some examples of
everybody
other guys.
Everybody just named. They got slower as they got older. They couldn't check
those
nobody.
These are Hall of Fame caliber players,
yes,
my brother.
Yes.
That's what I'm saying. It takes an elite
best
skill
in the league
set
as they got older is the point I'm making.
Do you get to count his... I understand what you're saying. Do you get to count his safety ability before he's done it?
Like, that's what I'm saying.
So to Moss's point, if he gets to year 10 of his career, moves to safety, and turns out to be a great safety in the NFL as well, then your point is pretty much clearly made as soon as that happens. The fact that he did it in college is cool, and I get that that's like an added feature. But if he only plays corner right now, and he's not like he's mixing it or has done some of both in the NFL, then can you really count that safety ability until it actually happens?
I mean, I guess because you haven't seen it on display in the NFL, exactly. But he played 4 years of it pretty much in college. So he played a lot of safety. It's in his background.
Right.
And
so
like, again,
not in his pro background.
He's the only player I've ever seen come out of the draft that was literally ranked top at two positions. He was the top corner in his draft class and the top safety in his draft class. But you know, that's all I'm saying about it. And that's you just never
so
see
maybe,
that.
Make that your point. Maybe he was the best coming out of college as far as defensive backs. That's true.
He's
say
the best
he's the best that we've seen in 20 years when we just seen a cornerback win defensive player of the year last year. It's kind of ridiculous. That's ridiculous. You can laugh at it, but he guarded, followed every number one every game and locked them up and led the league in picks. That's a defensive player of the year right there,
gotta
bro.
Give props on that.
Don't do that. Ramsey ain't never did that. Never did that.
I was just saying, he's a better player.
So I was seeing after the game that Adams put up solid numbers, but I heard that some of that wasn't on Ramsey.
Of course.
Don't think Ramsey had that bad of a game. He just gave up that early touchdown and had the tantrum.
And that's one of those
really bad.
That's one of those things that man to man, you can't guard that. You can't guard when they're doing all that motioning in the backfield and shit with the wide receiver, and then they get them out to the. It's a design man beater, regardless of who it is. You have to literally like somebody else has to jump that route, or you have to be in some kind of zone.
Like somebody's playing a flat right there.
You have to be in a zone in order to stop that. It's just impossible. The speed's gonna win every time on that. So I don't really fault them as much on that. But yeah.
I really didn't have many takeaways from that game. Like I said, it was better than I expected. It looked like Green Bay was going to run away with it early. Rams fought back, but it never really looked like they were going to win.
No.
They did the best they could. And
what was the final score?
Okay. 32-18.
Oh, okay,
they got a later touchdown to push it ahead.
Yeah. What happened is the Lazard dropped that big pass. And
then caught the next one.
But he caught the next one.
Right.
But that, if he would have caught that one earlier, the game would have been out of hand at that point. But it was pretty much the same play they came back to, and he ended up catching it. And that was all she wrote after that. Aaron Rodgers, man, he's a different level. He's a different breed of quarterback. To be doing that, well, what he's doing at this age, because we'll get into the older quarterbacks in the league, but, he's 36, 37, and you still don't see him doing so much with his feet and affecting the game in that way.
He's good.
I'm just saying.
Getting out of the pocket a little bit.
Right. I'm saying he's not Lamar Jackson, what I'm saying? He's
scrambling around the field and shit, but, yeah.
He's making it happen.
He'll make sure he don't get sacked.
Quick out there. He still looks quick. He still looks like Aaron Rodgers. You're not looking at Aaron Rodgers and saying he lost a step.
I think that's fair.
I mean, of course not.
That's all I'm saying. Yeah. He looks like Aaron Rodgers for sure. And that's why he won the MVP. So
we'll continue to get to these other games, and we can come back to it if we need to. But just so you know, you were 2-2 this week with your picks from last week. I believe you were 3-3 last week. I think me and Moss were 4-2 last week.
Maybe.
We were 4-0 this week. I just remember you saying a lot about, see, I told y'all I know more than football than you do. You're just not very good at picking games. I just want to say that. So tell us about how the Bills and Ravens game went for you and our bet. I appreciate your money.
Well, I mean, honestly, I thought, our bet was specifically about really Lamar and Josh Allen. I don't think either one of them necessarily stood out in the game. I think they both made plays of, during the game of plays that they're known to make. Like Josh Allen made a couple plays with his arm. Lamar Jackson made a couple plays with his legs. But it was more about the surrounding cast of those guys in that game. That's what told the story to me.
Really well.
The Ravens defense. I don't know. I mean, they played well, I guess, overall.
They gave up 17 points. I mean, the Bills have been lighting people up.
Yeah. But they didn't get any pass rush. I think that's what the problem with the Ravens defense is. But watching, Josh Allen was calling his girl, talked to his mama on the phone in the pocket, combing his hair.
When did this happen?
Y'all didn't see that? He was calling his girl, saying, shit, I'm chilling. And Ngakoue think he going to get to me, but he not. I'm just waiting for Diggs to come open. So, yeah, I mean, it was very noticeable. And then Lamar Jackson would seem like he was running for his life the entire time. So I think the bigger story was that Josh Allen has a better surrounding cast, specifically offensively, than Lamar Jackson does.
That's fact.
That's a true statement. I don't think that's like a fair assessment of what happened. I don't think Lamar played bad by any means overall. But again, they designed the team to run. I mean, they have the offense.
And they did that, though.
That pick in the red zone really fucked the whole game.
That was the game. I mean,
that changed the game.
That was his first red zone pick. He threw 49 touchdowns. That was his first pick in the red zone. That's wild.
Well, I mean, to me, it goes back to
that and the tackle kicks. The shit that just don't happen.
That's what people don't bring up is Justin Tucker missed two early field goals. I think the game is different because you're looking at a 9-10 ball game at that point.
Been close,
maybe you're not forcing the ball into the end zone because they couldn't come across points. You know, if you're able to kick those field goals early. So, but I think it's just you got to get this man a target on off season. You got to get him an Allen Robinson or Kenny Galladay or Juju Smith-Schuster. You got to get him because look who he's throwing it to when he threw that pick six. The only dude in the red zone Mark Andrews. This is if you're the Bills, you know that's who he's going to. You know that's his only target in the red zone that can make a play. So, I think it's a bigger story about the surrounding cast. Lamar Jackson center threw what? Snapped the ball over his head. He had to catch it one snap, one handed.
Did you feel like deja vu when that happened?
Yeah. I was like, that's Pittsburgh Steelers game right there.
That's the play he went out too. That's the play he got the concussion.
Yeah, he got a concussion on that play.
It's an AFC North thing?
I guess so. J.K. Dobbins, I think before he threw the pick, J.K. Dobbins dropped a pass in the red zone that would have scored. Like he was wide open in the flat. He dropped two passes that game.
I think there was one towards the end that didn't really matter, but he dropped it in the flat.
Two passes in a flat where it could have changed the game. One was on a fourth and five. that he dropped the pass in the flat. So, you know, like I said, the surrounding cast just didn't really help out Lamar Jackson. And that's kind of been the story, at least the last two seasons to me, of Lamar Jackson in the postseason.
What about the fact that he had the MVP season 2 years ago? He has put up one year ago, right?
Last year.
I don't know, was it? Whatever. MVP season.
That was last year. Right. He won MVP. Mahomes won the Super Bowl.
He put up big enough numbers with the same general cast. I understand what you're saying. I think it's part of both. It's not one or the other. But I think if he gets a number one receiver, that'll help him a ton, obviously.
Yeah.
But he has accuracy issues. And he's not a pass-first guy. They limited and kept him in the pocket, not having great weapons doesn't help, of course.
You stop their running game, that leaves them handicapped a little bit.
Right.
Because they're not set up the other way.
But when does it go to the coordinator, though? When do you say, hey... But
when does anything fall on Lamar?
I mean, he has some... He has to improve, but you can't get a fair evaluation on him until you get him these things. It's just like... Nobody knew that Josh Allen could be the type of player that he is until this year. Josh Allen was throwing 52% last year until he got Stephon Diggs, and now he's throwing 70%. You have to get a fair...
last year.
I don't know about that. It was
50% 1 year, 62,
79. Garrett. All right, well, I mean, that's a 79% this year?
69.
Oh, okay. All right. I had to look at that. I thought it was 50-something percent. But
you might be right on that.
I think it was 52, 54, and then he jumped up to 60 this year.
I think you're right.
That's what I think. But it's specifically because I'm sure he worked on some things in the offseason. I'm not going to say it's just because of Stephon Diggs. But that's a major role into it. You don't just increase 20%. So I don't think you can have a fair evaluation of Lamar Jackson until you get him a number one wide receiver. And if you do get him a number one wide receiver and you still have the same criticism... same things are happening, then that's fair.
But what about the MVP season? That's my point, is he has done it. He has done it and been successful with the same coordinator, the same players.
But the MVP season, he was throwing it all to tight ends. He was.
But he did it. That's what I'm saying.
But I'm just saying
he's done it before, then sure, make those changes can help. Like,
it was so successful last year, why would they switch it up for this season?
But you can't keep doing the same thing.
MVP season last year, why would we tweak this and add different shit?
But you saw what happened once it
worked.
You saw what happened when they got to the playoffs last year, is that teams know how to scheme up for this. All I got to do is guard the middle. I can literally guard everybody. I can stuff the box and go one-on-one. If you get a number one wide receiver
season until that playoff game, the whole season.
Well, you play better teams in the playoffs.
Why switch it up? It ain't broke. We just lost the playoff game.
I'm not even going that direction quite as much. My point is, if it was successful 1 year and it still is the same resources this year, then sure, you can say that they need to make a change to improve it. But I don't know how you could blame the OC when it worked one time and it didn't the second time.
I think it's successful scheme. And I'm not just blaming OC. I think it's organizational failure. You know, the last great wide receiver that they had in Baltimore was Steve Smith. Steve Smith has been retired for 5 years. Before that was Anquan Boldin. They have not brought wide receivers into Baltimore to be successful offensively. It's, like I said, they drafted Rashad Perriman in the first round. He's a bust. They drafted Hollywood Brown in the first round. He hasn't been the guy that they need him to be to really take the top off the defense. So I think it's an organizational failure.
Partially because of the quarterbacks. It could be both. I'm just saying he's an absolute elite talent and he's a special player. He does things that nobody else can do. But if I was building a team and was picking a quarterback, there's probably 8 to 10 quarterbacks I would rather have because I think they pass the ball well. And I don't think that that's something that he does.
Well, I mean, I don't know about that. Like you said accuracy.
8 to 10 is a lot, but
I feel right. You said accuracy issues, but he hasn't. His completion percentage has been great since he's entered the NFL. Josh Allen literally had accuracy issues. His completion percentage was awful until they got him an elite wide receiver.
He's been the league bottom of yards passing the last 2 years, or at least this past year.
Just this past year.
Again, my point is about passing the ball as a quarterback. I don't think that's a strong suit of his. As a quarterback, I think that's a problem.
I just think you got to get a fair evaluation.
It would work if their defense was better. If their defense is better, it'll make a difference.
They just balled out last week, though. They don't have a bad defense. That's right.
You got to score more than 3 points in the playoffs.
A lot of times on the Ravens.
Yeah, where we at? Oh, the Browns. Chiefs, the fucking Browns.
That was a great game. I enjoyed that game a lot.
It turned into a great game. It did.
Yeah, it was.
It should have been a rout.
What way?
I do think Mahomes, they would end up blowing them out if Mahomes stayed playing all
those. Yeah, probably so.
Not even if Mahomes didn't fuck played
the play at the end of the second half, it would have been 16-10 with the Browns getting the ball back.
All right, but didn't Baker come out there and throw a pick first drive?
And they got no points out of it.
Because Mahomes was hurt. Remember, he tweaked his foot. And Mahomes wasn't really the same after, but you could tell.
I was like, he better be careful.
He wasn't hitting.
He was already playing.
He wasn't hitting the throws that you normally see him hit like that. The one that he missed to Le'Veon Bell, Le'Veon was wide open. All he got to do was put it in the corner in the end zone. Mahomes hit that 10 times out of 10. You could tell that he was like hobbled by that foot injury.
It was 16-10 going into the half. If they don't just ruin the play into the end zone or fumble it into the end zone. You can say all that other stuff wouldn't have happened, but you can also say Baker's not trying to throw crossbody over the middle of the field if they're not down 19-3 at that point as well.
Yeah, I mean,
it could have, should have, could always go a different way. Mahomes, when he actually left the game, is when it probably would have turned into a blowout later because they weren't going to stop him. Right. But I think up until the halftime, could have made a case the other way.
They was in it. They was definitely in it.
Yeah, I mean, and then Bucker missing, what? Two field goals, or I know he missed one extra point and a field goal. Yeah. So I mean, that just changed the landscape of things. I mean, really, looking at it, it was two players that I was impressed by when I was watching this game. One, Tyrann Mathieu. He was the best player defensively on the field. He was better than Myles Garrett was. Myles Garrett was just getting run around the entire time. He was just running around the edge on him. And he didn't get any sacks or anything like that. But he was making one-on-one tackles against Nick Chubb, got the pick. Against Baker, that was just like he was roaming the field. Like, you know, he was literally reading Baker's eyes. He went from one wide receiver to the next.
Him in tackles. Damn. He was balling.
He led him in tackles. Yeah, he was, like I said, he was the best player on the field. And then I was impressed by Baker. I thought once their running game got taken away, to me, I thought that, you know, it was really going to go downhill for the Browns, but they still found ways to move the ball because Baker was making really good throws. Sometimes guys were wide open, but regardless, he was putting it right on them. He was putting it right on the numbers, and when guys weren't wide open, he was putting it into tight windows. So, really, he made that one mistake that didn't really end up hurting them because they didn't get any points off of it. But I was most impressed by Baker and Tyrann.
He just got to finish drives.
Yeah,
you can't talk about that people's fumble. Higgins fumble. You can't do nothing about that. He did what he's supposed to do, but all the other drives, he didn't finish them.
You see what Stefanski said about it? Because I know you hate that rule about the touchback and shit.
It's a terrible rule.
But, you know, some teams have a rule where you don't reach out. They tell you, do not reach the ball out. That's the best
thing to do. We can run another play and get it in.
Right. And they would have scored. And that's what Stefanski said in his after the game interview or whatever. He said, you know, I never question Rashad's effort or anything like that, but he knows what our rule is regarding that. You don't reach the ball out. We'll just try to punch it in the next play.
I respect that, and I think it's good to take responsibility rather than blame the rule. But we know throughout the season, there is 250 touchdowns of dudes diving at the pylon and one or two of those plays
every year.
Like, these guys, I haven't noticed.
It usually happens in the big games.
Everybody's going for the pylon. It just unfortunately been.
Yeah, terrible. I mean, it sucks, terrible. Man. Yeah, great play by Sorensen.
And even saying they should have called that helmet to helmet because he hit him straight in the head.
That's tough for a referee. You already tried to diagnose if the ball was knocked out early and did it go through the end zone.
I think it was odd that they didn't even review it. Did they review it?
They reviewed the play.
They can't review that.
They can't review the helmet because there was no flag.
What about the end of the game? I thought in the fourth quarter, They had a fourth and one. The Browns had a fourth and one on their own 30 with like 7.5 minutes left. And I thought they should have punted.
They were still down 5?
Yeah. I thought they should have punted at that point. because they had Henny in the game, and you're on your own 30. If they get stopped there, they're fucked. They do the quarterback sneak, they pick up the first down. So what are you going to do?
Right.
The next one, they get 4th and 8, and they're down to 4 minutes left, and they punted. I thought as soon as they punted, they lost the game.
Probably.
Did you think they should have gone for that?
Well, you said it was a 4th and 8, right? I didn't see that play.
4th and 8, they're around the 40 of their side of the field, but there's 4 minutes left, and they only have one timeout.
Yeah,
so you're talking about KC gets 2 first downs, basically, and the best-case scenario, you get the ball with a minute left.
Yeah.
I thought that they lost as soon as they punted.
Yeah, you have no choice but to go for it in that situation. Especially as well as Baker was throwing the ball. I thought in those moments he was like the third down situations. Baker was making completions there. So,
And with 4 minutes left and you're only down 5, worst case scenario, you don't get the 4th down and you have to get a defensive stop, but you could give up a field goal and still be within a touchdown.
Right. Yeah. And they wasted that. They wasted a timeout on that stupid challenge.
Yep.
A Tyreek Hill catch.
That was a crazy catch.
Yeah, crazy catch. I get it, but he caught the ball. You know what I'm saying? You got to just hold the flag on that one. To me, that's a do or die situation. You got to go for it there. You can't leave it in your defense's hands. Your defense is not great. They just haven't been. Yeah. You got to expect that they're going to give up one of these plays. I know that you've gotten some stops in the second half due to Mahomes being out, but Kansas City still has great players that you can't guard. Yeah. Chad Henne can make a wide open throw if necessary.
And the point that Deuce said, he just played in their last game, a full game with them.
Right. I mean, he's not a scrub. He's a backup, yeah, but he's been in the league for a long time. He's not a scrub. So.
With the weapons that they have, you need somebody that cannot be terrible. And with that little bit of a game, you're not stopping Tyreek, Kelce, Williams was running the ball.
I forgot he was on the team.
You
are
the exact same. You are
the other team.
Yeah. What happened to Le'Veon?
Right? I assumed he easily slots in.
He fits what they do in offense.
He does, though.
I kind of think he don't, though.
His skill set
does. I don't think they play to put him in a position. I think he's like a 4th or 5th option type of shit.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he's
a 4th or 5th
he's
option.
He's certainly not the first option on
the They're looking at everybody else. They're like, oh, Le'Veon the flat.
But did you think that he would have gotten the start? Like, I assumed it was Allaire, Le'Veon, and then Williams, but they just put Williams in as their full-time running back.
Williams played good.
They did.
He was wrong.
Williams run with a different mentality. I was looking at Le'Veon like, I don't know if he signs another contract with the team after this.
It's what Le'Veon's always been. He's never been a downhill runner.
Yeah, he was.
He's a patient runner. He tries to find the hole. That's not how they run. They don't run the offense like that.
Yeah, but I'm saying Le'Veon can get downhill and he can run over some people and stuff like that.
He used to,
but I think Le'Veon looks washed. That's all I'm saying. He doesn't look like any resemblance of the same player that he used to be.
I won't say quite that far because I feel like he just didn't even get time. But
yeah, he didn't get
there has to be something said that the talent he used to be, and they're not giving him time. So
right. That's it.
I think you might be right, but I can't say for sure.
He wasn't good with the Jets.
We haven't seen it.
I get it. It's the Jets, but still, at some point, you would think you would have some kind of good performance.
Yeah.
It never came out that way, and he never really had a good performance with the Chiefs, which everybody was expecting to have. Some breakout game at some point. But I don't know. He looked washed to me.
Yeah. As they don't need him.
Definitely not.
He's just like an extra in case people get injured. I think that's why they picked him up.
Yeah.
It's a good backup to your backup.
Yeah, right.
Why they picked him up just to make sure nobody else got him, too.
Maybe.
You know, overall, that was a good game.
That was decent.
So the last game, I think that's enough with the Browns. It was a good game. Last game, Saints-Bucks.
Battle of the old guys.
I felt like this game was 5 hours long.
I think
I was just tired at that point anyway, but it just felt like it would not end. There was like some exciting plays and stuff, so I don't even mean it was like a terrible game. It just felt like it was long as hell.
Right.
Am I the only one?
I didn't watch till the second half, but I was looking at the stats and I was just like, wow, Tom and Breeze are really lighting it up. That's what I was at one point. Both of them had like 6 completions. maybe like 15 attempts or something like that for like 31 yards. And Breeze had a pick, and Tom Brady had one touchdown and 25 yards or something stupid. It's like super pedestrian stats.
My thing is, I feel like you put a little extra on it last night because you've been ready to get your shit off on Brady. You know he had a great season, so now he has a decent game, a not so great game. Well, he didn't turn the ball over, so it was an average game. And then you killing him because I guess he ain't throwing 500 yards. Like, Allen had a bad game. Moore had a bad game. Mahomes had an average game before he went out. Every quarterback had an average game. Nobody had a great game except for Rodgers.
Do you think he really jumped out the window last night?
I think he was jumping out. I think he was using that game to be a reason to kill Brady because he know he hasn't had a reason to kill him that much this season.
It won't just Brady, though. I said Breeze. Brady,
started with Breeze, yeah.
Ben, Rivers, all these guys need to retire. What I'm saying is, from a fan perspective, the game was not entertaining. You didn't want to see the quarterback play that you saw. I don't want to look at that when I'm watching a football game. It was not entertaining.
I don't agree with the Brady side. Brady was taking shots. He was putting it out there.
He made a couple good completions, a lot of shots he took down the field.
He only completed one shot down the field, but he was taking them shots. He just won't complete them. They're playing great. You forget that Brady threw five picks to this defense in the last two games.
Yeah.
This defense is elite. Their coverage is elite. They be on them receivers. So the fact that he didn't turn the ball over and he scored three times, of course, they have been put in position because of the defense, but that's a great game. You got the playoff there.
Yeah, I think they're good. And I'm not saying that these guys can't play. It's obvious that these people can still play the game, but the game has changed. It's evolved beyond them. I think you require your quarterback to do a little bit more now to really be like truly successful or to especially in the postseason. You need to move the pocket some. You need to do some bootlegs. And your quarterback gonna have to get some first downs with his legs. These are the things that we saw from
him. It's needed as much as you try to make it out to be.
I think it is. The quarterbacks that we're watching now and the ones that are really at the top of the game, that's what they do. Josh Allen's, Lamar Jackson's, Patrick Mahomes, even Baker Mayfield. Sure. This is what he's done throughout the playoffs. Ryan Tannehill, Aaron Rodgers.
Yeah, all the best are doing that. Brady's in that top five too this year. He's top three in the league, so it's like he's in that category without having to do that. So it's not needed.
All the quarterbacks I brought up had great statistical seasons.
I know what I'm saying.
But all of them, but they should retire because the game's evolved beyond them. Like, that's all I'm saying.
Let me get in the middle of this. I think what you're talking about is a scare factor where you don't have to worry about this extra realm that you have with all of the younger quarterbacks. Right. And I think when watching the game last night, there wasn't any point in time where the Bucs got the ball that I was like, oh shit, the Saints are screwed right here. Like, it doesn't. I think he played fine.
Coming off some turnovers? They scored off every turnover.
That's the only time they scored.
Yeah, I'm saying
on short field.
When the Bucs got the ball, it wasn't like there's not like the old Brady fear factor. Like, he's about to carve us up. He played fine. He did not play bad at all. I'm not trying to say anything bad about Brady. But the way he played last night, I do think he looked old. He did not look scary. He wasn't carving them up. He wasn't like 50% passing. He had less than 200 yards. They didn't move the ball that much. When they scored, it was off of turnovers.
Yeah.
One of them they got at the 3-yard line, I believe. So we got the 3-yard pass for a touchdown to Evans. Yeah. And all of the possessions started on the other side of the field. I don't think it's that crazy to say that he looked old in that game compared to what we're used to seeing with Brady. His season as a whole, you put up 40 touchdowns. That's a crazy year.
That's elite.
So he's top five, it's top not three. Like he's washed. Yeah. But when you watch the game,
I guess
he
I'm
did not,
not
look like he was a scary quarterback. He
I guess I didn't see it as old because I think the announcer said it. They played like they were the Patriots. They played that game like they was the Patriots. They was being conservative a lot of times. No turnovers. When we get the ball in position to score, we're going to score when we got the chance to and try to play good defense. Like, that's how they played the whole game. I think Breeze was of the looking old that y'all talking about. Because every time he threw it over 20 yards, that shit was sailing over people's heads. It was off target. He couldn't hit nobody. He was throwing picks. He was throwing wild picks. It was like, he just looked like he can't keep up no more. It didn't look like that to Brady to me.
Well, I feel like that, the thing is, though, Nobody would argue with that.
Right.
Now, he looks completely
washed. That's why I say it's a difference. I was like, I didn't see that from Brady. Brady was taking shots. He was on target,
He didn't hit a lot of them, but he was like...
But that's the point. There's a difference between looking like an old quarterback and being washed. Like, Breeze is done.
Right.
He could not get it done.
Okay, that's what I'm accounting to looking old. Brady didn't look that way.
Yeah, I think we're talking about different things. But if without the three turnovers from Breeze, I don't know how much the Bucs scored that game.
I mean, you could say that for the last two games. Without Brady throwing five picks, it might be a different game.
Right, but again, we're not going back to, like, compare the team. I'm just talking about last night.
I mean, sure.
Right. If that didn't happen, it wasn't like the Bucs offense was rolling. And when they were rolling, it was because of Ronald Jones.
Right, it was because of Rojo and
LeGarrette.
Fournette got a couple.
I'm not a LeGarrette. Fucking
Fournette. He had a decent.
You were right too.
Yeah, both L names. LeGarrette.
Yeah, he had a decent.
They both played well. They both played really well.
Yeah, they held it down.
Yeah, I don't have a whole lot to say about that game. Breeze was really bad. Michael Thomas had the same amount of catches and yards as we did. That's insane.
Did he really have zero catches?
Nothing.
Zero.
Shut him down. I was so happy because somebody was playing with him. My lineups had him. He had nothing.
Zero.
That should never happen. But, I mean, at one point, though,
he wants out of New Orleans right now, too.
Is that what he said?
He tweeted same with retweeting that Deshaun Watson. I went from 2 to 10. He is not happy right now.
I wouldn't be either. I mean, you get zero catches and yards. You know how diva wide receivers are.
For sure.
And it's one of the, you know, it's a guy who called 140.
I don't even think it's a diva. It was like, you the best receiver. How can I not get the ball in the playoffs?
He called 143 balls last year or some shit like that. You got to give him the ball here.
Absolutely. He was trash all year, though.
But,
even when they were playing well.
Why?
He's had a nice injury year.
I think football is of, like, organizations or maybe football coaches or whatever, they're loyal to a fault. You know, y'all think that as well? Like,
as far as what?
As Belichick's greatest asset is that he's not.
Yeah, Breeze should have been pulled from that game. Yeah, I know people will say you cannot.
I know you said that. When you said that, I was like, you know that's never going to happen. They will never disrespect a veteran QB or put him in a playoff game.
It's nothing that happened in that game where you thought, oh, they can get it done with Drew Brees, especially when they lost the lead.
That's not a football thing. It's just sports in general.
You can
make that case about Kobe in his last season. I know his last game he went crazy, but Kobe had a rough final season.
Yeah.
You could have made the case that resting him a little bit would have been better for the team. It just doesn't matter. It's sports, and it would hurt your franchise more than it would help that game.
Regardless, though, man.
And you believe in Jameis more than anybody else in the world.
He threw the touchdown. Did Brees throw a touchdown?
You did not see the play.
He was wide open.
No more than 20 yards. He threw a touchdown, but he didn't throw a touchdown.
It was a good ball.
Like I say, I think that was a personal play.
We're
let Jameis get a shot at his old squad.
Perfect pass.
Yeah, I mean, it worked out, but I would have, especially when the game was like, they fourth quarter, you know, 7 minutes left, and they needed to score. I think Breeze should have been pulled off the field. They pulled him off the field for Taysom Hill.
Look.
They would have put Taysom Hill in the game if they needed a spark. Why not put Jameis in the game?
They didn't pull him for Taysom Hill. He got hurt.
They normally would. In any other circumstance, if they need a spark.
No.
If Taysom Hill.
If Breeze is healthy, they're not pulling
him. He would come back in the game. Yeah, but I'm just saying, like, you would give Taysom Hill some snaps.
I think that helped them. That hurt them, too, Taysom not playing that night.
I think it did.
Maybe.
I know I've been judgmental about Taysom Hill, but they needed him to have a spark for them.
Something, but they needed to go down the field with the balls. Put Jameis in and let him go down the field a couple times. Drew Brees could come back in the game, but it was obvious that he won't going to bring you back into the game. You know what I'm saying? It was obvious at a certain point.
I'm not defending the way he played at all, but in the third quarter with 3 minutes left, they're up 20-13. The Saints are.
Yeah.
And they lose the touchdown. It's 20-20.
These are all Drew Brees picks, though.
Drew picks, yeah.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Like, this is all Drew Brees picks that make it happen.
The second pick to Kamara, they were running completely different routes. And the third one is tipped straight up in the air.
Yeah, yeah, right.
I mean,
right,
he played garbage, but it wasn't like he deserved to be yanked, I don't think. I think that's nuts.
Not to say that he deserved to be yanked, but if you wanted a chance to win the game, it came to a point Drew Brees wasn't going to give you that chance. That's all I'm saying.
I mean, okay. All right. Say that.
Fair enough.
I think that's a fair assessment of what I saw.
Yeah, you look trash. Disagree, they just not gonna pull them though.
It is what it is.
Ain't glad.
Yeah.
Wow. Next week, tell us who you're picking so that we can get them right.
Oh, okay.
Bucks Packers game one.
Oh,
who's your pick, and do you think it's a decent game?
I think it's actually going to be a decent game.
Give us scores, actually. Let's do scores. There's only two games.
I'm taking. I'm gonna take the Packers for sure. I'm not going against Aaron Rodgers right now. He's playing too hot. So as long as he don't come out and throw a pick six like they did last time when it was up 10-0 against the Bucks, I don't think it is going to be a 38-10.
They bust their ass last route.
Yeah, they fucked the Green Bay Packers up last time they played them. So I'm going to say the score is I don't believe in the Bucks passing defense. So I'm going to go with 34 to 24 Green Bay.
Okay. 31-17 Green Bay.
I'm going 28-21 Buccaneers.
Oh!
Because I don't believe in the Green Bay's passing defense. I think Brady gonna shred their ass up.
I think he's gonna shred that.
It's not gonna be like the Saints defense where every pass he was throwing to the Saints defender was right on their back. It's not gonna be that way against Green Bay's defense. He's going to get some guys open. He's going to take shots down the field and make some plays.
Green Bay got a decent pass rush. I don't know, man. We'll see. Well, you know, if we're talking about a duel of quarterbacks, taking Aaron Rodgers, brother.
Sure, of course. Why wouldn't you?
It's going to take Aaron Rodgers in that.
This is like the exact same case that you made last week when you said you were taking Breece. Just wanted to throw that
facts. Facts. You said it was a wash. Ain't going about to happen.
They were like, I think it'll be a close game, but you give me Drew Breece.
No, I mean, I said
the only reason why
I picked the Saints is because it's specifically off of the last two ways that the Saints won the game.
That's the reason why I didn't pick them. Brady was not going to lose to them three times in a row.
It was kind of headed towards that, but Breece couldn't get it done. Hey.
Bills Chiefs.
I'm
most excited about this game. Assume he plays, because I think there's no chance he doesn't.
Did you see he doesn't? They say he doesn't have a concussion. It was a nerve in his neck.
It didn't seem possible.
It looked like he hit his head.
No, he didn't hit it at all. I actually believe them this time. That's some shit that they would say even if he was concussed, just to make sure he plays next week. But I believe him this time.
But everybody's just assuming he's going to play, though.
Yeah, I'm saying for our picks, assume he's going to play.
I have no doubt that he's going to play.
How can I do that?
Don't pick the Bills.
I'm going with the Chiefs. I'm going to assume that Mahomes is going to play. I'll pick the Chiefs. The score, we're going to go with... I think this is going to be I'm going to go 14-31 Chiefs if Mahomes is healthy.
I might be wishful thinking, but I'm trying to get hyped this game. I'm going Chiefs 37-27. I want points.
It's very possible.
37-27. I guess I'll be the oddball.
All right.
And I'm going to go with the Bills in a close game, then one in... 24-21.
So what? Me or you is gonna pretty much win the picks overall for the playoffs this week.
Sounds like it.
Well, I guess we could split. 24.
I don't think it has. I don't think they have any chance of holding the Chiefs to 21 points.
It's not likely, but again.
Their defense has been good in the red zone, but both two playoff games they play, and I picked against the Bills every time they've
been winning.
But the defense has been good in one area that I didn't account for, and that's specifically the red zone. Phillip Rivers moved the ball up and down the field on them, but just couldn't capitalize in the red area a couple times.
Might be the game plan.
And the same thing, I mean, it may be bend don't break. I get that. That's a solid, but you can only do that to a certain point when you're going against guys like Travis Kelce and that bend don't break shit.
You don't want to let them get in the red zone.
Yeah, right. It's not going to work anymore. You know what I'm saying? You're going against elite talent. And it's schemed up well. Andy Reid is going to get his guys in the best position to win. So that's why I don't think they have a chance at stopping the Chiefs, because they haven't really stopped anybody except for in that one area.
And they gave up 3 points last week, so I'm not going to say they haven't stopped anybody, even if you did clarify in that one area. But
I'm just saying they gave up, they got outrushed by like 120 yards or some shit like that.
3 points.
Yeah, that's a fact.
So... we were talking about getting into music, and I did have that one sports music related shit. We got the song from Lil Wayne for the Packers, and Benny did the Bills Mafia joint like 2 weeks ago. I'm not saying that they're terrible songs, but I find the songs embarrassing.
They are bad songs.
A high school vibe, like rah rah cheer from my team. And these are two cool ass rappers, and I just don't like how it looks.
But I guess I was
Wayne's is
like,
worse.
Look at Little it like if you're a fan of one of these teams, you're gonna love this song.
Agreed.
Like Black and Yellow, even Black and Yellow.
Let me address it. It wasn't made to be
a Pittsburgh Steelers song, but you saying Black and Yellow and Wiz from Pittsburgh, it's y'all song.
Right.
And y'all fans love the song.
Pittsburgh fans don't really like that shit.
No, y'all like that shit.
No, they don't.
Y'all like that shit.
Because it's not even the color's not even supposed to be black and yellow. Pittsburgh colors are supposed to be black and gold.
Hell, get out of here.
Come
here,
shut up.
Get out of
like
here.
Like what?
No, seriously, though. You might think it's yellow, but...
You might think it's yellow. It is.
No, seriously.
It's
like
yellow.
Pittsburgh says it's black and gold. No, that's just
football vernacular. A ref is going to dress you as black and gold. You're not going to say yellow. That's just raw referee.
No, if you ask the owner of the team or anybody on the Pittsburgh Steelers, it's black and gold.
When that song popped off, y'all were playing it. After every touchdown, it was in the stadium going.
That was y'all's song, bro.
I don't remember that.
You sound crazy.
I don't remember that ever being a staple in Pittsburgh. No,
I think Wiz is different because it actually was a big hit record too.
And it wasn't like,
but
it wasn't designed.
It had nothing to do with the team.
It had nothing about the Steelers at all.
Yeah, no, it had zero to do about the team.
I didn't like him. I think you're 100% right. Right. And like specifically for Benny, it seems like it was a partnership with the Bills. He made it clean and everything.
Smart move.
They're doing memorabilia together. He's brought up on like pregame stuff and on ESPN. I think it's a smart move. I'm just saying, as a fan, I thought both songs were so corny. I hated them.
Wayne's was worse. For sure.
I was expecting that beat to come in. He was going off before the beat dropped. He was going in a little bit.
The beat sounds awful.
He remixed Black and Yellow?
Wayne sounds bad on the beat. It's just, what was that one line that he said? I got the...
I'm going to Alicia Keys Swiss cheese shit.
Yeah. I'm getting cheese. like Alicia like that Keys and Swiss cheese.
Came up in the trap or something. I done well in the trap. Aaron Rodgers with the pack. I got 12 on my back. That was an hard little bar. A little play on words.
It was all right. I think the only rapper that could do like a real specific team anthem and make it cool is Wale. I stand on that. He bodies though.
I'm surprised he ain't did one for the Skins yet.
Yeah, I am too. Honestly, I am.
What are you gonna say? I mean, what are you gonna talk about?
They did make it to the playoffs. He could have made one.
They did, but I mean, you gotta do a little bit more to get an anthem.
Made it as far as y'all did.
Yeah, they certainly did. And that was the reason. They're directly the reason probably why the Steelers went on at least they started the five game slip. Yeah, they did. So
they did get y'all first hand.
You can make a song about that.
I forgot about that.
Yeah, I didn't.
Not sure.
Yeah, I remember that shit. Yeah.
But Skins fans ain't never gonna let you forget, right?
Never.
Oh yeah, I mean it was 3 weeks later. Yeah, you remember?
we got y'all first loss.
we started all this chaos.
Yeah,
shut the fuck up, man.
Y'all listen to anything new this week?
Any new music? What happened? What dropped?
I know DaBaby dropped a new song,
video, whatever.
It's a hard
record.
I don't care for it.
It's a hard record.
I thought it was okay.
I like
it.
Good on the.
It's a DaBaby track.
It is.
Yeah, it's a DaBaby track. I'm good on those now. I've heard enough. I'm good on that. My boy dropped a new track. I thought it was pretty cool. Lil Papa, he dropped a track called Dope Man.
You didn't tell us, bro.
Okay.
Yeah, it's pretty
cool.
Why
didn't you tell us? Kind of listen to it. I could have heard it.
Yeah, it's real short. It's real short. The way it opens up, I don't know if I like it. It's a lot of auto-tune when it opens up, but then when he gets into the verse and stuff, it's pretty dope.
I'll have to check it out. You know my boy dropped.
Yeah.
Juice and
they got a video for it.
Yeah, they apparently shot that.
Lyrical Lemonade before. Video.
Yeah.
That's big.
They was holding on to that joint.
Yeah, right.
It was some video that they had just put out. Where they had like that video playing on a TV during the video. I forget whose it was though. I like that Cole Bennett. He does some dope videos.
Yeah.
I guess the first time in a long time I've heard a Young Thug verse and I was like, oh, that's really dope.
He killed it.
I thought his part was.
Is that your first time
in a long time?
From Thug?
in a long time. Yeah, I think Thug is like super overrated rapper. I like his shit, but it's just when people get into that Thug super lyrical type shit. Miss me with that.
I felt the same way, and then I heard a record. I think I said this on the pod before.
Yeah, we definitely talked about
on the Drake album. That song he had with him, with Thug and 2 Chainz. I think it was the one where he had his head in the clouds. One of the album. He went crazy on that shit. He was spitting some shit. I was like, yo, he kind of killing this shit.
I'm not saying he's not capable of it, because I know he is.
I think most of the time you just can't hear what he's saying.
Most of the time he's just really not saying shit.
Maybe.
Most of his verses he don't. Yeah, most of his verses he'll be talking about.
It's Future Baby.
So, but I do enjoy this one with him and Juice, for sure.
Division. They put out like a deluxe to their last album. They renamed it. I like how they did that deluxe though, because they put the new songs at the top instead of at the bottom.
That's how Roy did his too.
It's a smart way to move it, so you don't have to look to see where the album ends at. And shit.
Right.
I don't remember what your last song on the album was. Like, just go put it at the top. The songs you added.
That makes a lot more sense.
Yeah. I listened to a few songs. It was cool. I didn't listen when it first came out. I might look into them a little bit.
And who was that again?
Division.
I don't know if I ever listened to
him. Sounded OVO. Okay. It's a singing group. It's a singer and a producer.
All right, dope.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't know that's how it was.
Yeah. Singer, producer, dude. 1985. He's firing the beats. He'd be killing them.
That's dope.
That was cool. The only other song I even listened to that I liked was, is it Fredo or Fredo Bang?
Fredo Bang.
Fredo Bang featuring Dirk was a pretty cool song called Top. I think he did a deluxe album too. I don't know.
Yeah, I listened to that
joint. All the features were not for me.
Oh yeah, I didn't listen to it. I'm not really a fan of his at all. But you know, maybe he got something that'll catch my eye. I don't know.
But that was about it.
Yeah, only thing I got is the update on Lucci.
Oh, I forgot.
Your boy YFN Lucci. This shit is a wild story.
He turned himself in, didn't he?
Yeah, he turned himself in recently. But, all right, so, you know, we read off the charges that he got. It's a gang of charges that can land him in jail for life.
One murder.
Yeah, they say his bond has been denied. But, so, they went to do a drive-by. Lucci and his guys. Him and two other guys, I guess, went to do a drive-by on the ops. Mm. Lucci is driving. He is the driver of the whip. And so I guess they try to spin the block. It's a shootout that happens. They hit one of the dudes, one of the ops. That's the dude who showed up in the hospital. We got hit in the abdomen. But somebody in the vehicle got hit as well and died. That's the person who died. I guess that's the murder that they're talking about.
But ain't got no name.
What they did is some real street grimy shit. They just dumped their boy out of the whip.
Damn.
So, yeah, your boy got shot.
They didn't even take him to the hospital?
Didn't take him. No, they just dumped his dead body out. And that's the body that they found.
That's fucked up.
Right. That's just wild. I guess more details to come out.
Scared or something? I mean, it's dirty. That's your homeboy.
I've heard about that before, though. Like, because what can you do? You can't go to the hospital.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Just got into a shootout.
There's too many questions. You can't go to the hospital. That's what they do.
Gonna be called,
they dump your body out. It's fucked up. It's some real street nigga, grimy, dirty shit. But that's what happens when you do these type of things and your boy get hit. You can't go nowhere, you know, to get him no medical assistance. And they probably already deemed or saw that he was dead anyway.
Right.
And you can't keep my man in the car, you know.
Just logistically. You still keep him in the car until you find somewhere to put him.
Yeah,
I just dumped his body.
Dump him out. That's how
at the scene of the crime, made it easy for him.
I'm not sure if it was at the scene of the crime, but they literally rolled the body out of the vehicle.
That's wild.
Yeah.
Damn, Lucci.
Not looking.
So are you a fan now?
I might listen to something. See if he really talk about that shit.
To me, that shit's
just stupid though. It's like. You're doing too much. Is like I said, you got to separate yourself. You way too up here to be doing shit with these people.
This is in Atlanta, right?
Yeah, in Atlanta.
That's wild.
Yeah, wild story, right?
Are you eligible for a pardon if you are not convicted yet? Because Trump's got 100 pardons tomorrow.
I don't think so.
I don't think that's how it works.
Yeah, right. I don't think that's how it works.
Do you think your boy catches a pardon, Kodak?
I hope so. I don't think so. But I hope so, man. Free Kodak, man. I don't even know
how you decide who gets a pardon.
Right, right.
I think
he should, because what Kodak's in there for is not like, it's like a paperwork crime, you know what I'm saying? So, and he should, but, you know, we'll see. We'll see.
Exactly.
Right now, he's going to have to wait until 2022.
Sounds like it.
Yeah, that's what I think is going to happen.
Well, then, speaking of Trump, we even talk about your boy, Men on Punishment.
Yeah, I think we can do it real quick. So, follow up to last week and our discussions about Trump and the censorship and all this stuff.
Right. He back.
Facebook and Instagram, well, Twitter as well, had a pretty big drop in their stock after banning him. And Facebook,
a lot of supporters
specifically,
on those
had a lot of investors that were scared away from the way things were looking. So about 4 days later, Facebook and Instagram reactivated his account. Everything's good again. He's not a danger to anybody.
Just a smack on the hand, man.
Once the money starts not flowing, they said, bring them all back.
Yeah.
So like we said last week when we were talking about it, get that shit out of here like they cared about anything. They were trying to do what they thought the people wanted. And then when enough people didn't want it, they said, oh, okay, sure. Back again.
Right, right.
It wasn't no safe bullshit. It was because they're money driven.
Yeah, just get bothering all of this shit that goes on, you know?
It's crazy, man.
Nobody's real no more.
Question everything.
Nobody stands on that shit no more.
Nothing.
Now, it's just everything's temporary.
I question everything. Never just take what the media tells.
Yeah.
I agree with that. Just gotta get you to critique a little bit more.
I do.
Hey, that's another day.
I do.
We are really short on time here, so we're gonna wrap up this video. If you're watching on YouTube, we appreciate you. We'll be back next week with episode 84.
No doubt.
And if you're listening to us with the audio right now, stay tuned. Them samples are coming.
Yes, indeed.
Deuces.
Peace.